So I am giving a short talk on invisible disabilities on and off the comments page. And I just wanted to issue a brief content warning that this does cover some medical trauma and some sexual trauma. And so if you need to get up and leave, if you're uncomfortable, no worries, feel free to do so. And with that being said, this is my story. 188 days ago, I woke up and couldn't get out of bed. This marked a 6-month-long health journey that still isn't over. A lot of the time, I felt like I was working against the people who were supposed to be helping me. At one point, I was labeled as drug-seeking and refused care, and unfortunately, for a lot of people who were assigned female at birth in Ohio who have severe chronic pain conditions, this experience is all too common. I had to learn to advocate for myself. I had to learn how to bring people to appointments with me so I'd be listened to, and I had to carefully track every single symptom so that I would be believed. For a long time, I was fueled by the idea of finding an answer, a cure, an end to all of this. Well, that led to experiencing a lot more trauma, unfortunately. And 6 months later, I still don't have any one answer or any one cure. In the past 6 months, I have been diagnosed with fibromyalgia, dysautonomia, cervicogenic headaches, small fiber peripheral neuropathy, and psychogenic non-epileptic seizure events. Since that's a lot to explain when people ask me how I'm doing, I just tell them that I have FND, or functional neurological disorder. Functional neurological disorders, a lot of the time, are linked to an extensive trauma history. Essentially, the way I see it is that my body and my nerves are trying to protect me from danger, but just like me, my nerves are always late to the party. I've had an incredible support system throughout this process, but I've also had some people talk pretty sideways. I've been told that all I do is lay around all day. I've been told by doctors that I'm too chipper to be sick, or that I don't look sick, or that I'm not really as sick as my chart says. So all of these comments made me feel like my pain was invisible. And unfortunately, this invisibility and this feeling of invisibility is not unique to me. A lot of people with invisible disabilities and neurological disabilities have imposter syndrome about not being disabled enough. And especially with those of us with disorders that fluctuate and flare, it can be even more confusing. Some days you might see me without any mobility aids at all. Some days you might see me with a cane, sometimes a wheelchair, and sometimes I'll just have to stay in bed all day. So the next time you see somebody utilizing accommodations who doesn't look disabled, remember people like me. So for my research, I've been interested in invisibility long before I got sick. My main research object is the empty speech balloon, or as I have called it, the ESB. We think of empty speech balloons as places on the comic page where words and message aren't there yet. But I'd like to ask you, what if the emptiness was the message? I first came across this when I read Una's Becoming Unbecoming. And in it, she talks about not being able to talk about her sexual trauma. And she uses an empty speech balloon to depict this. I was so fascinated by this. And so I tried to find anything I could on it, and there just wasn't any research. So I combed the Billy Ireland Online Archive for 3 months and found everything that I could. And I finished my master's thesis and published it, and I called it Signifying Silence. But I'm still not done with the empty speech balloon. I'm doing my dissertation at OSU, and I'm going to be using the empty speech balloon as a framing object. So why is the empty speech balloon so compelling to me? I want you to ask yourself, what does silence look like? How would you draw it? Well, some artists have done just that to show the inability to speak and the inability to hear. For example, Georgia Weber is Dumb covers 6 months in which Georgia did not have a voice, and they use the empty speech balloons to show that time in their life and the conversations they weren't able to have. In Cece Bell's El Defo, Cece uses different magnitudes of empty speech balloons to show the varying levels of sounds of things that she can't hear. But to Cece Bell, deafness is not a disability. It is her superpower. In a special ASL issue of Hawkeye, Matt Fraction and David Aja use ESBs to elicit a feeling of isolation. So this is a great example of how diverse the empty speech balloon can be, because there are two very different perspectives on the same symbol. And this diversity starts to answer the question, if the symbol is an empty space, how do we know what the message is? Well, we have to look at the framework within which it's presented. The theme of this talk is Between the Lines. And when you think about Between the Lines, I'm guessing you're probably thinking about a space between lines on a book page, or between panels on a comic page, or even margins. But I would invite you to ask yourself, what if Between the Lines could be an exchange between lines, an interaction, an intersection of ideas? Since the empty speech balloon can be anything, it is inherently intersectional, and it has been used to signify the silence of trauma and disability, but it can be used for much more. Personally, when I became suddenly disabled the day after my birthday last year, on top of everything else that I lost the ability to read effectively. I will look at the page, not understand it, try to concentrate, and get headaches, tinnitus, and uncontrollable twitching. As a PhD student in English, an English professor, and somebody who worked at a library, this was pretty devastating. Books are so important to me. Along with this loss of reading came the loss of my ability to speak about what I was experiencing. It was so unlike a situation that I couldn't have or knew anybody who have ever had, and it was so much to process that I couldn't communicate with the outside world. That's when I turned to art to communicate. The first piece, which you'll see over there, is called Communicate with Your Doctor. And all of the art that you see over there helped me find my voice during this time. This time also made me question, and I'm still questioning, the idea of graphic medicine and medical humanity, and this idea of communication between doctors and patients. This improved communication will literally save lives, so it's really important to be thinking about. It's also important for me to share my story because it's not just my story. And the fact that I'm up here is due to a lot of luck and a lot of kindness, and a lot of people just don't have that chance. So for me, sharing my story is a privilege and also a responsibility. To that end, there was no graphic memoir that I could find out there about functional neurological disorders. So I decided to make it. and I decided to call it Sensitive for a few reasons. Firstly, one of the ways that my disorder presents is that I have hypersensitivity to touch, to pain, to temperature, everything. I'm also, as my family can tell you, a very emotionally sensitive person. So on a scale from 1 to 10, I feel things at 11. Also, as a biological female, I've been called sensitive before in order to diminish or invalidate how I was feeling. So that's what it is. My goal is to help others like me, because for queer disabled people, storytelling can be an especially radical. But autobiography is a powerful tool for everyone to claim control over their narrative. So I would like to help you all use that tool today. And here's where we move into the fun interactive portion, where I go Oprah and say, open your bags under your seats. In your bags, you have a few things to take home with you. But among those are an index card and a TEDx pen. So if you're able to find those and bring those out, no pressure at all on time. At home, any piece of paper and pen will do. Sorry, I couldn't get enough for everybody. So as you have your index cards and your pens, I want you to ask yourself, what is an important part of your story? What's something that you've never been able to tell? What's a story that makes you smile? Anything in your narrative that you think is worth claiming. And I want you to write down that idea on that index card. It can just be one word, it can be a whole paragraph, anything that will help you go back to it and remember it later. And no rush if you need to take it home and meditate on it, that's totally cool too. When you go home, I want you to make it part of your story. And when you're done, if you would like to, feel free to tag me in your posts so that I can share in this with you. Every one of you has a story, and I would be honored to participate in a part of it.